I think that's I'm worship with us this morning. Good morning, BC family.
Welcome to church this morning. We're glad to see you guys here. Please stand if you're not already standing, and we'll go ahead and get this morning worship started, all right?
You freed me, held back the waters from my relief. Thank you. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for allowing us to get together this Sunday and worship you and hear your words, dear Lord. May this message reach the hearts that need to hear it most. Thank you so much. Amen.
Good morning. It's always good to see you, even if I can't see you. Because of those lights are really bright. But we have been in a series that we have called Mirage. And really what the whole idea is, we're chasing after things in our lives that we think that if we can just obtain these, if I can just reach this, if I can just get there, if I can just get this or that, whatever it is, then I will have purpose in my life, I'll have meaning in my life, I'll have significance in my life. But we realize in the pursuit, somewhere along the way, we find out once we arrive there, that it's just a mirage. That whatever that thing is, that if I just obtained it, whatever it is, once I got there, I found out that it wasn't real, that it was a mirage. And that when I get the end result that I thought that I would expect, we don't end up where we want to be. And so in this series, we've kind of talked about the idea in the pursuit of money and stuff, the pursuit of perfectionism, the pursuit of fame. And this week, we're going to talk about the pursuit of comfort. Now, I don't know about you, but over the last couple months ago, once everything started happening with Russia and Ukraine, every night, especially when they first started the invasion, every night I'd watch the news. I'd turn on the news, and I'd watch it probably about an hour or 2 hours every night, just kind of following what was going on and what was happening, and you're heartbroken over everything. You're kind of wrecked by this tragedy. But I was glued in. But then what happens? What happens is that after a couple of weeks of watching it, our interests begin to fade. Why? Because over time, the more we become comfortable with something, the more that thing becomes, we become apathetic and stale with it. I mean, think about it. The more comfortable we become with something, the more apathetic we become. Think of your relationships. Maybe you're in your marriage and your dating life. I mean, just think of the difference between dating and married, right? When you're dating, you do things that are just contrary to what you do when you get married. And when you're dating, as guys, like, you start writing love letters. You write poems. You know where the florist is. You do things. You shave your back. Right? You put cologne on. You do things that you're well groomed when you're dating. Women, it's the same thing. You shave your legs. You exercise. You go out to eat for dinner, and you order like the sad salad with a water. Like, you just don't want to go all in day one. But when you get married, I mean, it's just nothing. You don't do the same things when you get married. For guys, like, we're lucky to get up from the table, from the couch when we're watching TV, to just have dinner. For women, I mean, you get dressed up, but it's those dress, right? It's not the dressed up like we used to get dressed up. It's just different. Why? What happens? Over time, whatever it is that we're doing, when we're doing something for a long period of time or even a short period of time, what happens is we become comfortable. And when we become comfortable, that relationship or that thing or that life or whatever it is can become more apathetic and more stale. And it happens in our relationship with Jesus as well. And maybe when you first get saved, you're so excited, you're telling everybody, you're telling your neighbor, you're telling the people that you work with, you're telling your family, everybody that you get in contact with, you're sharing about what God has done in your life and just how excited you are and how God saved you and what He saved you from. And everything for that first couple months is just so exciting, and you're going all in your relationship with God. But what happens? And life. And we get comfortable. And we stop doing the things that we once did. And so now we pursue this idea of being comfortable. Like, if I'm just comfortable, if I can just relax, if I can just calm down, if I can just be comfortable, that's what we pursue after. And Jesus tells us a story. He's having a conversation with the religious, and the way that he answers this question that the religious expert has, he actually tells a story about it. And so there's a conversation where Jesus is having a conversation with the religious expert, and he kind of goes like this: what do I have to do to get by? He asks, what is like the bare minimum? What do I have to do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus answers the question. He says, okay, what do the law say? And so the man answers him, being a religious leader, being a religious expert. He says, well, the law says, love your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and then you love your neighbor as yourself. And then the guy does exactly what we would do when we were back in class. Remember when you had those classes that you're like, all right, what do I have to do just to get by? Like, I don't want an A. I don't need an A. I'm not that smart. I'm okay with that. But what do I have to do just to pass the class? And that's what this guy is asking. Essentially, he's saying, hey, how can I be comfortable in my life and still get by? And so Jesus goes into a parable. Jesus goes into a story. And here's what Jesus says. He says, in reply, Jesus said, a man was going from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. And they stripped him of his clothes, they beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. And so the man asks the question, okay, if all I have to do is the law says to love your God with all your mind, all your soul, all your strength, and everything you've got, and to love my neighbor as myself, then who is my neighbor? Like, what's bare minimum? Who do I have to love? And so Jesus is telling the story. Hey, a guy was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. He was attacked. He was stripped of his clothes. He was beaten. He was left half dead. And then he says this. He says, a priest happened to be going down the same road. And when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. And so he saw the guy lying there. He's lying there. He's struggling. He's suffering. He's hurting. He's begging. He's asking for help, anybody, to give him a little bit of help. And this priest walks by and he sees him and is like, oh, I think I got a phone call. And he ignores the situation and he walks on the other side. He pretends like he just didn't see it. And you think, okay, well, maybe that's just one person. Like, one person didn't see what happened and what was going on. And so Jesus continues the story and he says, hey, another guy, a Levite, another religious leader, when he came to the place and he saw him, he passed by on the other side as well. And so you have two religious leaders, two spiritual people that saw a man that was in need, that saw a man that was hurting, that saw a man that was in suffering. And both of them looked at him and said, you know what? I've got other things that are more important to do. This is a powerful image that Jesus gives us of how we seek after comfort. He saw this guy, and here's what he said. I don't want to get involved. I don't want to risk that much. I've got too much going on. I've got a really good job. I've got a secure position in the temple. I've got a good reputation that I've got to keep up. If somebody sees me helping this guy, it could be cause some trouble. And I've got a busy life, and I don't want to live any dangerously. And I don't know what kind of shape he's in, so I really don't want to get involved. What is he saying? Man, I'm comfortable. Jesus would say, hey, there's got to be something more than that. In fact, one of the things that that people call our generation, they call it the meh generation. You know why? Because when we're asked questions, that's the answer that we give. How do you feel about this? Meh. Well, what do you think about this? Meh. And what, do you want to get involved? Meh. Are you passionate about this? Yeah. Like, whatever it is, we're just kind of laissez-faire about this. We're just content to. Nah. There's no real passion. There's no real desire. And I think that as followers of Jesus, that God has called us to do more, to get out of our, to leave the pursuit of comfort and say, you know what? If there's somebody hurting, if there's something that's going on, I've got to look around me. I've got to look at my surroundings and say, you know what? This life isn't all about me. And so how is it that we're looking at tragedy going on in our world, but we're looking at what was happening in Russia, and we saw the shootings last week in Buffalo, and 10 people are shot by a person that goes into the supermarket, and we're being... But how do we just kind of go past them? How do we see these things going on, but yet we live such comfortable lives? And I think that there's a couple of theories that I want to throw out to you. I think there's some things that that are worth talking about. Three opinions, three ideas that I want to give you. Why don't we care? Why don't we step out of our comfort zone like Jesus has called us to? And I think here's the first one. The volume of information is overwhelming. The volume of information is overwhelming, right? Did you ever think of just how much we're exposed to at any time, at any moment? Like, for example, you can go on Twitter, you can go on Instagram, you can go on Facebook, and it just from scrolling, you can have different things. You can read about an earthquake in Nepal. The next post could be about a cat that falls into a river that nobody wants nor cares about. There's a car bombing in Syria. There's a friend that is started a GoFundMe account for a 12-year-old who needs surgery. There's the face of Jesus in French toast. Like there's so many different things that when we're scrolling, when we're looking through, we're exposed to so much information that is overwhelming. And there's so many different things that here's the honest truth. It's hard to care about each one. Like when you're reading through and you're scrolling through and you're seeing information about a bombing or a shooting, and then the next information is something, a funny meme, it's hard to process those things when the information is so overwhelming, when there's information we're being exposed to so much. So when we scroll through it, when we see through it, here's what happens in our minds. It's just another tragedy. It's just another earthquake. It's just another bombing. It's just another tornado. It's just another shooting. And we've gotten so desensitized to life and reality because there's so much information we're bombarded with every day. And so how do we get out of the comfort zone, and how do we care and love the way that Jesus called us to, instead of just walking on the other side, instead of ignoring what's going on? Well, I think one of the reasons why is because the volume of information is overwhelming. Here's the second idea. We feel helpless to make a change. We see something like that, we see something going on, and we think, well, I'm just one person. Like, what can I do to make a difference? I don't have the money. I'm not in that place or not in that location. I can't make a difference. Besides, I've got my own things that I've got to deal with. I've got class that I've got to make sure that I attend. I've got bills that I've got to pay. I've got to keep my job. I'm trying to get my 2-year-old potty trained. And good Lord, if they do not get potty trained, if they don't learn to wipe their own butt, like it's overwhelming, right? We feel like there's so much going on in our lives that we feel helpless to make a change somewhere else. Right? There's just so much going on. And I'm just one person. I don't have the resources. I don't have the time. I don't have the location. I feel helpless. And so what do we end up doing? We don't care the way that we should. Like, what am I going to do to make a big difference anyway? And so why don't we care? Why don't we step out of our comfort zones the way that God has called us to? I think the volume of information is overwhelming. I think we feel helpless to make a change. We think, well, there's just nothing I can really do about it. I think here's the last one. We're blessed and cursed with comfort. It's such an incredible blessing. And at some point, we've got to acknowledge that. We've got to embrace that. That everybody, that we have so much comfort here in our lives, and we are blessed with that. But we're blessed with the comfort that at any point we can open up an app. I mean, you can do it right now. Open up Domino's, in 30 minutes you can have a pizza in your chair, right? If you want brunch, you can have a pizza in 30 minutes. I mean, we're blessed. If you want a new pair of shoes, all you gotta say, Alexa, buy me a pair of shoes. And according to your ordering preferences, in 2 days, Alexa will send you a pair of shoes that are your size, and it's going to be at your front door. I mean, that's comfort. That's a blessing. You can binge watch your favorite show right now. I mean, I don't do it, but you can. You've got the access to all the information. You can binge watch whatever show you want until what? It starts buffering. It starts buffering, and then, I mean, we're calling on the work of God to stop the demons inside of our TV because it's buffering, right? Life is so hard.
Well, life is so, it's just not fair. I can't watch The Office without it buffering. And so we're blessed and we're cursed with comfort. And here's the thing, the more comfortable we become in our lives, the more our lives tend to be about us. The more comfortable we get in our lives, the more comfortable we are, the more our lives become self-centered around me and creating more comfort. Comfort becomes like a drug in our lives. That the more that I have and I just get a little bit of comfort, it's like, man, I can do this. And more, and a little bit more. And we want our lives to look very comfortable. And before long, as Christians, we're actually trying to leverage God to be a God that, God, I just want you to give me what I want. I want a God that makes all my problems go away and my bank account to go up. Like, I want a God that I don't have to hurt, that I don't have to suffer, that I don't have to go through things. I want a God that just makes my life just a little bit more comfortable. And so we are blessed, but we're cursed with comfort. And so how do we as a generation, how do we move out from overcoming this attitude of comfort? How do we break from being the generation? How do we move forward? And so what I want to do, I want to give you one big thought on that. And so here's the big thought for today. And it says, how do I overcome this idea of comfort? And here's what I would say. Consistently expose yourself to something that creates a righteous discomfort. How do I get out of the comfort zone that I'm in? How do I see that there's more to life than what I'm currently living? This idea that life is more about me and my comfort and me being okay. It's consistently exposing yourself to something that creates a righteous discomfort. Just think about that first word, consistently. If there's a lack of consistency, there's a lack of interest. If there's a lack of consistency, there's a lack of consistently exposed to something, it pushes you. But the moment you stop thinking about it, the moment you're not consistently in front of you and it's not consistently in your face, the moment that hurt, and maybe you've understood that, you hurt for something, but the moment that thing is away from you, what happens? We forget about it. But we don't think about it. We're not exposed to it anymore. And so what happens? Our interests go back to ourselves. Let me give you an example. Back in August 2005, Hurricane Katrina ripped through Louisiana, Mississippi, and in that area, New Orleans. And I was living in Florida at the time. And a week after that happened, there was about 30 of us that found a church in Biloxi, Mississippi, and said, okay, we're going to partner with this church. And every day we're going to go into Louisiana and we're just going to help people. We're going to get trees off of houses. We're going to tear out, because of the floodwaters got so high. Construction workers were going in, but they were having to tear out from one end to the other. All you saw from 4 feet down was just studs. Everything else was gone. Like, it was just gone. We were taking huge big screen TVs. We're taking them out of the house because they were just trash. And you're going through this and you're kind of thinking through, man, these are the things that people have worked for their whole life. And we're going through their whole house. Things that they have loved, things that they have worked for, things that they were passionate about, things that we're passionate about, things that we work hard for. And we're just bringing them out to the front so that someone else can take it off as garbage. And here's what you think. You think, you know what, from this point forward, it gives you a different perspective of things, right? I remember thinking, man, how blessed, incredibly blessed I was. I remember thinking, man, I'm never going to be the same. I can still remember the smell of things. Like when you're somewhere where things have been rotting, I mean, you just don't forget things like that. You don't forget just trees being in the middle of houses, and we're trying to cut the trees up and get the trees off the houses. It totally, for that week, man, I felt so ruined inside. I felt so wrecked. I thought how materialistic I was. And I thought, you know what? This is going to change my life forever. And so you devote yourself from this point on. I'm going to be different. I'm going to care differently than I cared before. I'm going to invest differently like I invested before. The things that upset me before, things that I took for granted, man, I'm just not going to do anymore. And what happens? What happens? The moment we leave, the moment it's not consistently exposed to you, the moment you leave and you go back to your life, in your house, in your world, and it's not consistently exposed to you, what happens? Life takes back over. And the next thing you know, I've got to pay bills. I've got to go to work. I've got the cat has to go to the vet. I just put it down. It's causing a lot of problems. Just kidding. I'm so sorry about cat livers today. But what do we do? What do we do? Life just becomes so overwhelming. And we go back to the comfortable routine. Here's the thing. We can have such an experience with God. We can have such an experience. Maybe you've been somewhere. You've been overseas. God has given me the ability to go to Argentina and Chile and just see poverty like I've never seen in this country before. And you go to these places and you think, man, this totally wrecks you. But what happens when you leave? We go back to our comfortable lives. And so that's what I'm saying. Consistently expose yourself to something that creates a righteous discomfort in you. What's a righteous discomfort? What do I mean by that? I mean putting yourself around things that move you on behalf of God. So things that you know move the heart of God, that move you as well. To say, you know, I just can't sit here anymore. I can't just do nothing about it. I've got to make a difference in this world that God has put me here for a purpose and for a plan. And I can't just sit here comfortably and do nothing. Like, God has put me here, and there's a righteous discomfort. There's something in me that I can't just settle down. I can't just stop. It's a spirit of righteous discomfort. So how do we overcome the spirit of comfort? It's by consistently exposing yourself to something that creates a righteous discomfort in you. Paul did this. Paul had this type of experience. I want to show you one of the most moving passages in Scripture, but let me give you some context and background to what Paul was saying. Paul was not always Saul. Paul was not always named Paul. Before Paul was renamed by God, Paul, his name was Saul, and Saul hated Christians. He hated Christians. He actually hated them so much that he would put them to death. And so Saul was going out and he was murdering Christians. He's actually responsible for the first martyrdom that we have, the first Christian that died in Scripture. Saul was there holding the coats of the people that killed him. This was the type of dude that he was. Saul had this radical encounter with the presence of God. And immediately, this guy's life has become so turned around, so flipped around, that he went from being a Christian hater to one of the boldest Jesus-sharing, gospel-moving people that lived in the history of our world. Paul consistently exposed himself to a group of people that created within him a righteous discomfort. And I want to show you some of the boldest, most other-centered statements that anyone can ever say. And so to preface this, he says three times, hey, what I'm about to tell you, I'm telling you the truth. I want you to grab that. I want you to hear that. I want you to, with every part of me, I ache for this group of people. And here's what he says in Romans chapter 9, verse 1. He says, with Christ as my witness. That's the first one. He says, what I'm telling you, he says, with Christ as my witness, I speak with utter truthfulness. He says, everything that I'm going to say is going to be God-honest truth. That's the second time he promises it's going to be true. Here's the third one. Conscience and the Holy Spirit confirm it. So Paul's about to tell us something that he really wants these people to understand. Paul's about to tell us something that he's like, I want you guys to know. Three times I'm telling you, this is true. This is true. This is true. And here's what he says. My heart is filled with bitter sorrow and unending grief. It's filled with bitter sorrow and unending grief. Why? For my people. My Jewish brothers and sisters. He says, this is my heart is it's overwhelmed. I have this righteous discomfort that there's no end to this anguish in my heart. My heart is so overwhelmed for this that I'm constantly exposed. I've got a righteous discomfort within me for my people, for my Jewish brothers and sisters. And here's what he says, that I would be willing to be forever cursed, cut off from Christ, if that would save them. Here's what Paul is saying. He says, I love them so much. I'm so moved by them. I have so much righteous discomfort within me that God has given me such a passion for these people that I would be willing to be damned to hell forever if just some of them, if I could just save them. If I can just see them come to know Jesus as Christ. I mean, that's passion. That's somebody who's moved by the heart of God. That's somebody who's moved by the things of God and says, hey, so just come. I am that I'm willing to go to any ends. I'm willing to go to any means to see the grace of Jesus Christ moved in these people's lives. I'd go anywhere and do anything. That's the kind of passion that I think God desires for us. I think that there's a passion that God says, you know what? I've given each of you a righteous discomfort, that there's something in each of us that when we hear that, when we feel that, when we see that, when we touch that, man, there's something that hits us just differently than everything else. There's a part of us that we get righteously discomfortable about. That life is no longer. But God, I want to move out of my comfort zone, and I want to do everything. I want to pour everything that I've got into seeing this come to fruition. I want to make a difference in this world. So how do we get out of our comfort zone? It's by consistently exposing yourself to something that gives you a righteous discomfort, something that moves you to make a difference in this world. And so how do we do that? How do we do that? Here's I gave you the main idea. Here's the two ideas. Two big thoughts from it. Here's the first one. Focus on something. Focus on something. Because let's just be honest. There's so many different causes in this world that grab our attention. Let me give you a couple that just come to mind. For some of you, you are deeply moved on the behalf of the unborn. That you must represent and help protect the lives of those not yet born. For others, you're moved by racial injustice. That somebody has to do something about this to bridge the gap between us. For others, it's human trafficking. For others, it's clean that around the world, that if we could just build one well for these people, it would give them a clean drinking water so that they don't have to die. For others, maybe it's cancer research. You have had somebody that you love, and you think, you know, if I could just pour some time or energy and resources into cancer research, man, that's what I'm passionate about. For others, it's fostering or adopting. It's helping children, strong families. For others, it's student ministry. You know, for me, my heart leaps when I hear about teenagers that help them fulfill the plans that God has for their life. For some, it's overseas missions. Like, do we realize that I think it's 3 billion people live on this world that have never even heard about the name of Jesus? Like, for some of us, that breaks our heart. We say, oh man, I want to go overseas. I want to be a missionary. I want to share the love of Jesus Christ with other people that have never heard about that. That hurts your heart. For others, it's community groups. It's discipling and helping people grow in their relationship with God. For others, it's mental illness. For some, it's helping people find freedom from pornography or addiction or alcohol or drugs. Whatever it is, that's just the beginning. And so here's the thing. There's so many different things that we can be passionate about. And so I understand that there's so many different things that catch our attention. But here's what I want you to ask. What are the few things that capture your heart? Like, not what are the things that catch your attention, but what are the things that absolutely capture your heart? That when you think about, man, you know, it breaks the heart of God and it breaks your heart. That maybe you get righteously angry over, you get upset about, that you feel it within you, and that God gives you these values, God gives you these principles to make a difference in this world. Focus on something. Here's the thing, when you get passionate about it, there's probably someone or some organization that's already doing what you're doing. And so here's what I'm saying, you don't have to start the wheel. If God has given you a heartbeat or a passion to do something, find other people that are already doing it and join in and partner with them, because they've already learned and they've researched and they've done it. And stay focused on something. Don't lose focus. Don't try to start something. Find someone who's already doing something what you're doing, and then stay focused on it. That's what Jesus did. When you look at the life of Jesus and you think, well, Jesus, why did you come to earth? Like, what were you passionate about? Jesus repeatedly said the same thing over and over and over again, just in different ways. And that's what made him such a good leader. A good leader can say the same thing in different ways and it just hits us differently. And so, Jesus, why did you come? Well, I came to seek and to save the lost. He was focused on why he was here. Why did you come? I didn't come for the righteous, but I came for the sinners. I came that you may have life and life more abundantly. I didn't come for the healthy. I came for the sick. Jesus, why did you come? I came to set the captives free. Over and over and over again, Jesus is saying the same thing, but in different ways. Why? Because Jesus was focused on the reason why he was here. And he was able to attract other people, attract attention of other followers who would become leaders of his cause. He was moving towards the kingdom of God. Why? Because passion Focused passion attracts other people. When you are focused and you are passionate about it, what happens? Man, that attracts other people to become a part of the cause. And that's what Jesus did. There were other men who were willing to leave everything that they had, everything that they worked for, the whole family business, to say, you know what? I believe what you're doing. I believe what you're doing. And they joined in the passion and the pursuit. What Jesus was doing, focus on something. And so here's the thing, we can make a little bit of difference in a lot of different ways, or we can make a really, really big difference in one or two places. Focus our attention. What am I passionate about? Well, what is it for me? What is the thing? What is it that I'm called to focus on? For me, it was, I grew up in the church, but I didn't really understand the gospel. I thought because I believed in God, because I went to church, that's what made me a Christian. So what am I passionate about? I'm passionate about helping people that don't know Christ find life in Christ and not just go to church. That's the beginning point, but become the church. Because we are Jesus followers. And so we're not looking for a church that meets my needs. No, we are the church and we meet the needs of the world. That's the things that I'm passionate about. Ashley and I, we're passionate about seeing people grow in their relationship with God. Like, these are the drive us. Because let me just be honest. The most comfortable thing for us to do is to stay on the sidelines. The most comfortable thing for all of us to do is just relax. Just go back home. Just not attend church, not be a part of something. Keep to ourselves. Stay out of the game. It's the most comfortable thing that we could have done is say, you know what, someone else. There's so many churches already reaching people. Let someone else do it. But no. God gave us a passion that we just could not. There's a righteous discomfort within us. This man, we've got to do something. We've got to reach more people for the kingdom of God. And we want to see people that once they understand the kingdom of God, to grow in their relationship with Jesus. That's the things that wake us up. Those are the things that we are passionate about. There's a lot of different things that we can do to put our time and effort in. But here's the thing, if we're going to make a difference, if you're going to make a difference, it's not by putting your time and energy and resources in every little thing. It's by focusing on one or two things that absolutely break your heart. And here's what I know. As soon as you say, you know what? I can make a difference. You know what? My life is here. My life has purpose. My life is, God has given me a desire and a passion. Here's what's going to end up happening. The first conversation you're going to have is with the enemy who says, you know what? You can't make a difference. The first person that's going to try to talk you out of it, it is going to be the enemy. He's going to say, you know what? You don't have that resources. You're not that good. You've got issues. You've got problems. You've got your own stuff. You'll never make a difference in this world. And so the first enemy that we're going to face is the enemy himself, that's going to constantly be telling us lies about who we are or what we've done, and going to keep us from following after God with everything that we have. To step out of our comfort zone. Because what does he want? He wants you to stay there. And the enemy would love for you to stay in your comfort zone. You're not advancing the kingdom of God there. But the moment you say, you know what, God has given me a passion. I want to step out. I want to get out. I want to go see what God has for my life. I have a purpose. Be careful and be ready. Because the enemy's going to attack you. He's going to attack you. But here's... Comfort makes excuses. we'll make excuses. Well, I don't have the time, or I don't have the finances, or I don't have the resources. I'm just not good enough. Do you know what I did last night? Do you know the issues that I'm struggling with? Comfort will make excuses, but passion finds a way. Comfort will make excuses for you to stay where you are, but passion finds a way for you to fulfill all that God has for you. And so here's the thing. Focus on something. And then here's the second thing. Embrace what hurts. Embrace what hurts. Right? Remember Paul said, he says, my heart is filled with bitter sorrow and unending grief. He embraced the hurt. Like there's things that in your life, man, it kills you inside to think that other people are going through something, or maybe you've gone through something in your life and God wants you to use that in someone else's life. And in fact, sometimes that's why God puts us through things. It's so that you can help and you find the comfort from God and you give that comfort to someone else. In fact, here's what scripture says about it. In 2 Corinthians, it says this: praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father in compassion and the God of what? The God of all comfort. And listen to how he comforts us. Who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble that we have been comforted by God. And so here's the thing. Sometimes the hurt that you're going through, the pain that you've experienced, the suffering that you have gone through, God has brought you through that so that you can now comfort other people. So that now you can help other people who are going through the same hurt, the same pain. Paul said, hey, my heart is filled with bitter sorrow and grief. There's a discomfort within us. And here's the thing. We can walk away and say, that's not me. Right? That's the story that Jesus told us. We can see the hurting. We can see the suffering. We can see the problem. And we can walk on the other side. We can walk and we can pass right by. Or we can embrace the hurt. Why? Because comfort you comfort in your situation, not comfortable, but he's given you a peace that you've embraced the hurt. He says, you know what? I am so moved and passionate about that I would rather hurt with a purpose than exist without one. I'm going to buy into the lie easier not to care. Well, it's too risky for me. It might cost me something. It might cost my reputation or my popularity or my social status. I might get my feelings hurt. I would rather hurt with a purpose than exist without one. I would rather hurt with a divine calling on my life, a passion, than to exist without one. I would rather cry myself to sleep. No, made to make a difference, and I want to make a difference, and I'm not making the difference that I want to sit instead of binging my favorite show and wasting my life doing nothing. I would rather ache, hurt, and pain because of the calling and the passion and the purpose that God has on my life than idly sit by in my comfort zone and do nothing. Embrace the hurt. If our version of Christianity is all about our comfort, then we're following a false God. If I never give sacrificially, if I never serve anybody, but everyone always serves me, if I never pray to be moved by something in my heart, if I never fast to deny myself of something so I can seek and tap into the power of God, if I never just just sit around and weep over someone or something, that I'm missing one of the biggest blessings that God has given us, and that's the blessing of a burden. Think about it. Moses lived with a blessing, was blessed with a burden. Moses was, he was so moved that his people, that the Israelites, were held captive for 400 years, that he had the boldness to go into Pharaoh and say, "Let my people go. I'd rather hurt with a purpose than exist without one." David was so blessed with a burden that this little shepherd boy, when he went to go see his brothers and check on them, he saw the whole army of God afraid of this one man, Goliath. And he heard Goliath talking about and ridiculing the God that he served. And so what does he do? What does he say? How are you coming against the armies of the living God? And he strikes Goliath dead. That is living with a burden. He's blessed with a burden that God had to have victory in his life. Nehemiah was serving a king in the palace and is brokenhearted over the walls that have been down in Jerusalem for 800 years. And he says, "I'm so burdened with a purpose," that he asked the king, "Can I go back? Can I rebuild the walls?" And he does, and he gets other people involved, and he rallies the troops. He fight for what's done. Fight for your children. Fight for your brothers. Fight for your sisters. Fight for your families. He was blessed with a burden. Jesus was blessed with a burden. When Jesus is overlooking Jerusalem, here's what he says. In Luke 19:41, he says, "As he approached Jerusalem and saw the city," what did he do? He wept over it. Why? Because Jesus was so filled with a passion, a burden, that it moved him to weep. "I'd rather hurt with a purpose than exist without one." And so some of us, we pursue the mirage of comfort. Of saying, where, you know, if it hurts, if it, you know, what are the things that move your heart, that move the heart of God? What are the things that you are passionate about, that you know that God has put you here for a purpose? That this is why I'm here. And that I'm going to leave my comfort zone to fulfill all that God has for me. Because in the end, we find out that comfort is just another mirage. Something that we thought would give us fulfillment, satisfaction. And when we get there, we realize we're left empty. I want to close with a Franciscan blessing. It's a prayer for our church, but all each one of us. And I'll have it up there on the screen, but I really want you to listen to what it says and pray it as well. "May God bless you with discomfort and easy answers, half-truths and superficial relationships, so that you may live deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, exploitation of people, so that you may work for justice, freedom, and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, and war, so that you may reach out your hand and to comfort them and to turn their pain into joy. And may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in this world, so you do what others claim cannot be done." Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for who you are. And God, I pray that you would bless us with a burden. That our lives would not just become a pursuit of comfort, but yet a and pursue out of our comfort zone to consistently expose ourselves to something that gives a righteous discomfort in our hearts and in our souls and in our mind. God, it's so easy to believe the lie that we can't make a difference, that we're not good enough. But God, because of who you are, because of what you've done, you've given us more than we could have ever asked. And so God, we move with boldness and passion and purpose. God, we pray that you would bless us with a birth. Maybe you're here today and you've never put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sin and to give you eternal life. Maybe that's the first desire and the first uncomfortable thing that God has put in your heart is to become a follower of His. If that's you, I'm going to pray, and there's nothing magical. The prayer is opening up our hearts to Jesus. But would you pray something like this? Dear Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe that you died for me on the cross, that you were buried, and that you rose again. Today, I turn from my sin, and I trust you with all of my heart and life. God, thank you for being my Lord and my Savior. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. We give God the glory this morning. You said, Mike, today I put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And we would love to hear about your decision. If you would fill out your connection card, find one around you, and just hand that to Ashley and I. We'd love to give you some resources to help you grow in your relationship with God. Would you stand? We're going to sing one more song together while we close out.
the rise. Let all agree, there's no power like the power of Jesus.
Team. That's these amazing people that help us put everything together, that sing, that handle the tech stuff for us. We would love to talk to you. You can come talk to Michael and I about it after service, but we had talked a little bit about it this week, and you know, God calls us to serve, and it's not just that we come in here and we have all this stuff to do, but it also is a life-giving thing, because you know, I think God put us all together to build each other up, so when we have struggles, we have that team to fall back on. We have people that are in your corner, that are fighting for you, praying for you. So it's just a great opportunity. It not only helps the church, but it helps you too. So, and we have prayer group this coming up Wednesday night at 6:30 at the Black Lantern. So we'd love for you guys to come out and pray with us. Or if you have any prayer requests, you can always let us know beforehand too, so we can pray over those. So thank you guys so much for coming today. We love you. We're praying for you. And we will see you next Sunday.